use some subsonic tunnel. Subsonic tunnel. So, as usual, you may know the subsonic tunnel where we have the section and then we have a diffuser and then nozzle, right? So here in the test section we are carrying a static port in the test section where it is fixed to an inclined manometer, and then the test section again it carries a pitastatic tube. So from pitastatic tube we are estimating the velocity using this formula, and then through this inclined manometer we are measuring the readings of the increasing static pressure, that is via the wall surface of the wind tunnel. So that is wind tunnel test section. So here we are using this relation, that is Bernoulli's principle. So from this we are estimating, so divided by and then by rho, so V is equal to square root of 2 P naught minus P divided by rho. That is this formula is executed from Bernoulli's principle, where P naught is the total pressure, P is the static pressure, and half rho V square is the dynamic pressure. So since we are maintaining the total pressure as the constant atmospheric pressure, that is before running the tunnel, what is the pressure we know down is called as total pressure, that is the level of inclined manometer, and then we are measuring the value of pressure. So here we are fixed with that inclined manometer filled with water or ethanol or any other liquid substances we can carry for this low density flow measurements. Here, since we are using air, air is said to be the low density fluid compared to the fluid which is taken here, so that it is highly recommended that we are using the high density fluid for any airflow measurements. And then here the values of P naught minus P, that is total pressure, inclined manometer, and then static pressure which is measured from the test section. So the change in these values will give you the value of dynamic pressure. So from dynamic pressure we are calculating the velocity. So here when you are operating the tunnel, this value is said to be the accurate value and this value is said to be the calibrated value. How? So here inside the test section we are carrying this pitastatic tube where you exactly measure the value of this pressure head H. So this pressure head H only gives the value of accurate value of velocity which is held inside the test section. But on the whole the tunnel is running, right? So where we have the increase in velocity in the nozzle and decrease in velocity in the diffuser, on the whole overall which the measurement held on the outside the tunnel is said to be the your velocity, exact velocity, and this is said to be the calibrated velocity. This value of calibrated velocity is found always very low, and this value is said to be the accurate value. Why this value is said to be low? This is because of losses present inside the test section. Maybe the losses may occur in the pitot probe also. So where exactly the pitot tube is held? If we deviate the position of pitot probe, we have some experiences such that if we align this pitastatic tube in a three-dimensional view, it's look like this. So if you deviate this path like this, so any angular changes will makes the reading to change, that is your total head may change. So this is the main problem of occurrence of a pitot-static tube as well as the other cases, right? And next we are going to discuss about the supersonic tunnels. What are the types of supersonic tunnels and then its classification. So initially, supersonic tunnel is said to be an intermittent wind tunnels. So intermittent means short range. Intermittent means short range. So short duration. It operates in short duration. So maximum it can operate up to 5 to 10 seconds. So you may have the question that why this supersonic tunnel are operating in short run condition and why can't we run for a longer run? A longer run tunnel is there. So this is the longer run tunnel, that is continuous tunnel. And compared to longer run tunnels, shorter run tunnels will give you the accuracy as well as the varying Mach number conditions. All priorities are given to short run tunnels, but for longer run tunnels you should operate 2 to 3 hours for the complete duration to attain the total pressure value inside the test section. So this is the major drawback, that is longer run tunnel should be operating continuously for up to 2 to 3 hours to get the accurate stagnation pressure inside the test section. But in these short range tunnels we are having the test section, so here we can operate this test section with stagnation pressure readings of different conditions where the exact stagnation pressure can be recorded in the settling chamber. Let us review about this concept. That is, first one is blow down tunnel and then draft wind tunnel. So this is the blow down tunnel, this is the draft tunnel. So what is the major difference between blowdown and wind draft? So blowdown means here the process is carrying in a singular direction where pressure moves from fluid moves from high pressure to low pressure. Here the fluid moves from again high pressure to low pressure, but the point of consideration is different. Here in blowdown tunnel you are storing the high pressure gas in a storage tank. Here you are storing a low pressure gas in a vacuum chamber. So this is the major difference between draft and blowdown. So blowdown is high pressure, is run with high pressure storage tank. Here in draft it is run with vacuum pressure tank. So here vacuum pump is there. So when you run the vacuum pressure we can have the very low atmospheric value pressure. So that is we are maintaining, if we are considering the outlet pressure, that is atmospheric pressure, as 14.7 psi, here we are going to store this storage pressure at a result of about 5 psi. If we set 5 psi, if we have 14 psi, we can have the tunnel up to the Mach number tunnel in the test section. That is, in the test section the maximum speed attained should be around Mach number. So how this case is attainable? But here in high pressure storage tank you have to maintain the higher psi. So more than this higher psi, like around 20 psi we should say, and then we are having the diffuser section as well as silencer section where all are open and it is open circuit. So both these tunnels are open circuit. So in this open circuit we are having high pressure 20 psi, and then in the silencer section, that is in test section, after this pressure regulator section, right, we have this section as an atmospheric section operating at 14.7 psi. So here it is not up to 20 psi, it is up to 200 psi, that is it should be 100 times greater than the atmosphere, right? So this is the case, it should be 10 times greater than the atmospheric pressure. So that is the case we have to operate. But here it is that we have to maintain from the atmosphere, we can maintain the number of times to a single fraction. That this is the range we are operating the driving pressure. So for every supersonic tunnel, we are considering the driving pressure. So here high pressure and the atmospheric pressure, when we subtract it, we are finding the driving pressure. So driving pressure is equal to high pressure minus low pressure. Here is also driving pressure is equal to high pressure minus low pressure. What is your high pressure here? What in terms of is the high pressure, and then low pressure is your high pressure. So these are the things we have to note down about this blow down wind tunnel as well as the interactive wind tunnel. But when you are coming with the concept of closed circuit wind tunnel, that is continuous tunnel. So this continuous tunnel are operating in this condition where we have the compressor, and then cooling towers, and then air cooler, and then we have a nozzle, and then diffuser. Continuously it is operated by turning vanes. So this is nothing but turning vanes or corner vanes. So using this turning vanes, the flow has been regulated, and it has been carried through a large ducts of uniform ducts, and then it has a return passage, and it is going. That is, the air is getting circulated completely inside these sections. So how you are going to store this air? So for this, we need a compressor, and then where the air is having some kind of oil. So in order to remove that, we are using the oil remover, and then we are having dry air in order to heat the air, and then dry air is maintained in a storage tank, and then here some regulator valve is there. When you open the valve, the air gets enters, and then we have a driver motor, that is a compressor. We should run the compressor continuously. So in this compressor, it is connected with the air cooler, because here in dry air, hot air will be coming. So that you have to, when after the hot air enters into the compressor, again it is heated up, so that we are using cooling towers and air coolers. And after cooling towers and air coolers, we are having a flow screens of nozzles. So this flow screens used for flow stabilization as well as for flow straightness, so which it maintains a uniform flow inside the test section. So this is a major thing of operating condition used in continuous wind tunnel. But the operating time is 2 to 3 hours, and then this type of continuous tunnel is very costly than the blowdown and the interrupt tunnel. So in blowdown tunnel, here it is operated using a gate valve, then pressure regulator. Pressure regulator is the important thing for maintaining the pressure inside the settling chamber. So this settling chamber pressure is said to be a constant, a regulated pressure, and then it reaches the nozzle and then test section. Here wide angle diffuser is there. Why you are using wide angle diffuser? You will be questioning that. That is, when you have the pressure stored or released by the gate valve, the air directly enters here, so that in order to regulate the flow or regulate the pressure, you are using this pressure regulator. So for achieving the constant pressure in the settling chamber. So when you achieve the constant pressure without a settling chamber, when you directly release it to the nozzle without wide angle diffuser, what happens? This pressure is not held constant. In order to make the pressure constant, we are using this wide angle diffuser to increase the pressure to a certain extent. So pressure regulator helps to control the flow, as well as wide angle diffuser pressure increasing rate. And then we are having nozzle. So the nozzle and the next section, continuously we are having test section. In this test section, we are going to keep any kind of supersonic models. And then we are using sclerent method, and then we are using some flow measurement device we can keep inside the tunnel, and then we can measure how much is the velocity or how much is the Mach number present inside the test section. And then we are having the diffuser section. So again, this diffuser section is a reverse nozzle diffuser, so which is operating like a diffuser. Nozzle is operating like a diffuser. Again, this reverse nozzle diffuser is nothing but the, again, CT nozzle. So here convergent portion and then divergent portion. And then we are having a silencer. Why we are using silencer is that when you are running the supersonic tunnel as a open circuit, and that is in blowdown circuit, so on that time enormous amount of sound is produced. So this sound is maybe around the decibels, which disturbs our human hearing. Okay, it may be around 85 decibels, so which disturbs our human eardrum, which is up to our hearing level only. It is that when you hear that sound continuously, then your eardrum will get weights. That's a major issue. That is sound problem. So that when you are running the supersonic tunnel, you should always wear earphones or earbuds when you are running the supersonic tunnel. And similarly, here for interrupt tunnels, we are using dry ice here. Why we are using dry ice here means, so we are operating with a low storage vacuum pressure. So when this valve is opened up, all the high pressure atmospheric air is getting entered into the, or all the air is getting rushed up into the tunnel ducts. So during rush up, okay, when you imagine without dry air, so it deflects the flow screen and the air enters here. So during that, liquefaction happens. Liquefaction. What is meant by liquefaction? Here it is said, when the air is blown at a speed of supersonic speed, at the time the temperature drop occurs. So due to the temperature drop, what happens? We will have the droplet formation around the ducts of the tunnel. So in order to reduce the droplet formation, or else air is turned into liquid form during this high speed run, so that we are using dry ice. So dry ice are used for having the hot air which enters into the flow, and then flow screens, and then dissection, and then diffuser, and then to the storage space, that is vacuum storage space. So this will get neutralizes, and this tunnel is operating at low sound decibels up to 60 decibels, so it doesn't make heavy amount of noise. So after this, we have the basic introduction of supersonic tunnel, and then we are going for calibration of supersonic tunnel. So in calibration of supersonic tunnel, here we are going to measure the distribution of Mach number in the test section for each of the available speeds. It's very, very important that you should always know about this concept. So for every supersonic tunnel, or a hypersonic tunnel, or subsonic tunnel we are considering, or transonic tunnel we are considering only the Mach number, that is flow speed by sound speed. So Mach number is said to be the important parameter for operating your flying models. My flying model is supposed to be a subsonic, or transonic, or supersonic, or hypersonic. So when you are operating these internals for calibration purpose, we need to know about the Mach number. We are only worrying about the Mach number. So that the distribution of Mach number in the test section for each available speeds is the important calibration point. And then we can also have the nominal Mach number. That is, a nominal Mach number is that with respect to stagnation pressure, your stagnation pressure is held constant. When stagnation pressure is held constant during that time, a nominal Mach number. So this nominal Mach number will changes with respect to this stagnation pressure. So how can we have this nominal Mach number? So with respect to losses, with respect to test section, nozzle varying condition, so we should have the change of nominal Mach number has to be calibrated. And then the third calibration is that the flow angularity. So the flow angularity is that the deviation of the flow. So deviation means here the flow is getting deviated towards left hand side or right hand side or upper side or lower side. So this is the flow angularity deviation. So these are to be considered for the supersonic term, for mainly for calibration. And then explain the dryness needed for negligible measuring difficulties. So what is mean by dryness? So I have been mentioned about dryness factor. So since the flow is having from high pressure to low pressure, right, there will be the factor called liquefaction. So in order to constrain this parameter liquefaction, that is to reduce this liquid formation inside the ducts, we have to maintain the dryness ratio. So how much will be the dryness needed inside the tunnel during the calibration or operating condition of supersonic tunnel. And then we are going to see about longitudinal static pressure gradient. This is said to be the important parameter where the static pressure gradient should be checked in all types of nozzles as well as in diffusers. So nozzle is diffuser is said to be the important parameter for achieving the Mach. So in order to achieve the Mach number or nominal Mach number, we have to design the nozzles and the diffuser section together with this parameter called longitudinal static pressure gradient. So when you measure this longitudinal static pressure gradient, that is we are having a long cylindrical tube arrangement which is held in the center portion of the nozzle, and that it is connected with the diffuser section also. So during this calibration, we will measure the static pressure gradient of the nozzle as well as diffuser. So this will give the pressure variation of in the nozzle, pressure variation in the diffuser, right? So from this we can design the nozzle section as well as the diffuser section. And the final, we are going for turbulence level measurement and cone transition to nozzle. So what is your turbulence level? So all these supersonic wind tunnel are operating greater than 1. So it is always said to be a high Reynolds number flow. So why it is high Reynolds number flow? Because velocity is high. So on consideration with respect to this factor, we are considering the viscosity. So when we are having the high Reynolds number, when viscosity is here, we are treating the viscosity as a negligible parameter, and then we are having the large conical sections which is carrying inside the tunnel. So all these conical sections, that is when your conical section may be a nozzle, may be a diffuser, but your test section is always a square section. So for this consideration, turbulence level measurement is very, very important. So when you achieve the transition level of Reynolds number, you achieve the turbulence level. So in order to make this turbulence level, the amount of turbulence intensity which has happened inside all the ducts, we have to calibrate all these things in order to achieve the better Mach number inside the calibration unit. Let us see one by one in detail for this calibration process. So at first we are going to discuss only about this distribution of Mach number in the test section. How can we calibrate the Mach number inside the test section? So using some empirical relation and then the theoretical calculation on paper. So today's session is only about this first topic, and the remaining section we can discuss in part 2 of this calibration of supersonic wind tunnel, that is the second module of my video, right? Now let us see the distribution of Mach number. So the distribution of Mach number in the test section will have a constraint with 5 procedures. So what are those 5 procedures? So we have the Mach number I have been already told about this definition. And then what are those five pressures? The ratio of settling chamber stagnation pressure to the test section failure pressure. And then second one, the ratio of settling chamber stagnation pressure to test section static pressure. Third one, the ratio of test section pitot pressure to the test section static pressure. Fourth one, the ratio of some body surface pressure to stagnation pressure. And fifth one, the wave angle of some body whose dimensions are known, usually average up. So let us see one by one in detail. So these are the overall view of this particular concept, that is all the five pressure. So this is pressure number 1, 2, 3, 4, and then we have the fifth pressure. It will be presented at last at the end of this video. So here the ratio of settling chamber stagnation pressure to the test section pitot pressure. So in the diagram you may see about this particular thing. So settling chamber, and then convergent divergent nozzle, and then test section, and after then again this section. So this is your settling chamber. So the settling chamber stagnation pressure and the test section stagnation pressure is always said to be equal. So is it equal or unequal? We should have this stagnation pressure ratio. It doesn't maintain equal. So this is the calibration proportion. When it doesn't maintain equal, so during this case we have to estimate the value of this Mach number. If this Mach number m1 is equal to 1, during that case your settling chamber pressure, and then this is said to be the settling chamber pressure, and then P01 is said to be test section pitot pressure. So P01 is equal to P02 on the time it is operating in Mach number 1, that is in sonic condition. So when this pressure ratio increases, when you increase the settling chamber pressure using wide angle diffuser, on the time this pitot pressure is also increases, but it is not enormously increases than this. So P02 is always greater than P01. We have to set this as a important driving pressure to accelerate the flow inside the test section to achieve the Mach number. So for a normal Mach number operating in greater than 1.6 conditions, we are using this equation. So this is the important equation which is derived from Prandtl's relation as well as the supersonic flow. So Prandtl's relation, how this relation comes, you may know very well about the famous equation, that is P02 by P01. It is entropy relation. So R into ln of P02 by P01, and then Cp times ln of T2 by T1 minus R times ln of P2 by P1. So this T2 by T1 and P2 by P1 will be substituted from normal shock relation, that is from your Prandtl's relation. And after substituting these values, so divided by R here, so you are dividing by R on both sides. So Cp by R, and you know the value of Cp. Cp is gamma R by gamma minus 1. So R getting cancelled up, so gamma by gamma minus 1. So the power is ln to the power of T2 by T1 to the power of gamma R gamma by gamma minus 1. So since R and R are getting cancelled, so finally you are obtaining this equation. And then this minus half will again treat that minus half ln will again treated by P2 by P1. So this is P1 by P2 relation. So when you multiply these two relations, we will get the value of P02 by P02. That is settling chamber stagnation pressure and then test section pitot pressure. So using this relation, we can find the value of Mach number inside the test section. So this is your first initial calibration. So Like in subsonic tunnel, we have discussed earlier about the velocity measurements, which is measured outside the tunnel. Likewise, initially we can measure the Mach number of this supersonic tunnel. Next thing, we are moving to second calibration, that is ratio of settling chamber stagnation pressure to the test section static pressure. So your settling chamber static settling chamber stagnation pressure is set to be P naught, and then the test section static pressure is set to be P. So you may know very well about P naught by P relation. So P naught by P is equal to P plus gamma minus 1 divided by 2 m square all to the power of gamma by gamma minus 1. So by rearranging this equation, so by knowing the settling pressure, settling chamber stagnation pressure, and then static pressure, the help of static probe, we are measuring the static pressure, the test section. Okay, by estimating this ratio, we can again get the value of Mach. In all these values, we are maintaining the gamma value as 1.4. So for air, the specific heat capacitance of air is always said to be 1.4. In most of the supersonic tunnels, we are operating only with air, so that we are maintaining this value of specific heat constants, capacitance, as a constant term, and we are not going to use 1.3 or 1.2 of these values, because your hypersonic cases, during hypersonic tunnel, hypersonic cases, we are going to use this value of gamma, since gamma is changing in hypersonic case, especially Mach number. So don't worry about this. Here we are going to deal only with supersonic flows alone. So next we'll see about the calibration parameter. So this is nothing but the ratio of test section without pressure to test section static pressure. So how this particular relation came? So using this relation, we can directly think of this. So this is again we are using from the thermodynamic formula. So that is P by P naught 2 will be given by P by P naught 1, right, multiplied by P naught 1 by P naught 2. So you may know very well about P by P naught 1. What is the P by P naught 1? It is nothing but the same expression, plus gamma minus 1 divided by 2 m square only the power of gamma by gamma minus 1. And here again, what is P naught 1 by P naught 2? Here this relation. Okay, so when you substitute this P naught 2 by P naught 1, the same relation here, okay, we can have the cancellation step and finally we can get this value. So all nothing but empirical formulas we are using from the Prandtl's relation, and the result of Prandtl's relation equation, that is, we have been studied theoretically in compressible aerodynamics, and you know very well about these relations. Again, we are using these relations to estimate the value of Mach number. Again, we are getting this value of Mach number using this third calibration technique, that is Mach number. And the fourth one, we are using this ratio of some body surface pressure to stagnation pressure. So in this procedure, some assumption is there. So here we are using wedge surface pressure, that is wedge surface pressure and the wedge semi-angle. So here you are assuming the stagnation pressure, that is you are maintaining and stagnation pressure in the wind tunnel, which is stored as 2 bar at the initial case. This is main stagnation pressure. And then you are having your wedge surface pressure. So wedge surface pressure means here you are using wedge body. A wedge like wedge body which is kept inside the tunnel, and then you are measuring the pressure acted upon, that is static pressure. Make a hole, then bring it out, and then we are measuring the pressure using some tag at the outside support, that is data acquisition control, right? So from this we are measuring the pressure, so that is going to be a static pressure. So you are considering this stagnation pressure from the settling chamber, right? So here P02 is there, and then static pressure from the tag. So P2 by P02 you are computing. This is your first step of this process. And then from this process you are estimating the Mach number. That is, by knowing P2 by P02, you are using this relation P2 by P02. So m plus gamma minus 1 divided by 2 m square all to the power of gamma by gamma minus 1. Using this relation, again you are finding the value of Mach number, and then you are going and see the value of oblique shock tables. That is, you found this in shock tables. So in shock tables, that is in gas tables, you may study about this relation, that is oblique shock table. So in that oblique shock table box, you will found for m and theta. So your theta is said to be the wedge angle theta. It is supposed to be wedge angle theta. So for this Mach number and theta, we are finding the value of shock angle. Right, after finding the shock angle, we are having the normal Mach number. That is, for shock angles having some deflection, okay, you can't able to measure the values of pressure ratio as well as temperature ratio behind the shock. So if you are considering this wedge body of angle theta, this is supposed to be beta, right? So for every theta Mach number and every theta beta is there, okay? So you have to convert this oblique shock into normal shock, so that is like this, and then you are going to estimate Mach number behind it, what is it, increasing or decreasing. So here Mach number behind this is decreases, and then pressure increases, temperature increases. Like this, you may study about the normal shock wave property in compressible aerodynamics, right? And we are using the same relation, that you have to convert this normal Mach number, that is oblique shock Mach number, into normal shock Mach number. By converting this step, we can estimate the value of pressure ratio as well as temperature ratio, but temperature ratio is not needed here because we are worrying only about the pressure. So we have estimated the value of P2 by P1. And then for this M, that is initially we have estimated M, that M is having this P1 by P01 relation. So for any particular M, what is the value of static pressure to stagnation pressure ratio? And then what we have to do, we have to multiply both these terms, that is P2 by P1 and P1 by P02. When you have the product of these two terms, you will obtain the value of P2 by P02. Now we have to compare these two steps, that is sixth step P2 by P01 and the first step P2 by P02 should be equal. If it is not equal, you have to iterate from step 1. That is, you have to increase this value. Next value, if this pressure ratio is said to be 1.4 at the initial, you have to increase by 1.5 for the second case. So you have to do for iteration should be done for equality of the measured one, and that particular Mach number is said to be the exact Mach number. So this is the trial and error basis method by placing the wedge body inside the test section, and then we can measure the Mach number using this trial and error method. So this is one of the olden technique, where at the initial case, when supersonic tunnel was built, at that time they have used this method. Still older calibration method is there to estimate the Mach number. Here this is going to be the very oldest method. So that is, what they do is that when they keep the wedge body of known angle theta, shock angle arrays, right? So they are visualizing using shadow graph technique. In olden days we are using shadow graph technique. So when you pass a monochromous light into this test section, suppose if you are considering this pattern inside the test section, you are passing a light rays, right? And then within this light rays we are obtaining a shadow on the other end, okay? And this shadow has been recorded, the image has been recorded like this with shock waves. If shock waves is coming in again, we have the shock waves. Just they measure this shock angle beta. So what they do, by measuring shock angle beta and the theta, they are estimating the value of m using theta beta m relation, a simple gas chamber relation. So if you know theta, if you know beta, they estimated the value of m. But here this particular Mach number is not accurate. This is one of the olden method they have followed. So this method is not so accurate. So that why it is not accurate, here these are the reasons. So the wave angle is hard to measure the high degree of accuracy, and then any picture is probably an average value across the test section, or putting it differently, using wave angles over any reasonable distance. That is, this particular wave angle which is measured using the shadow graph technique should not be exactly accurate, because the image size may be too big or too small, and then the dimension of the body may not be exact. So that is pixels. By when you have the varying pixels, the angle may changes. So that is the thing, is the second case. And then some optical distortion is there. What is meant by optical distortion? That is someone having long sight, someone is having short sight. That is, they are having some problem in their eyes. So when they are viewing, and then our human being is always having the view called perspective view. So when you look upon any subjects or any objects, each and everyone is looking on that object on different perspectives. So one may have one angle, the other may have the other angle. So likewise, they have the optical distortion. So due to that, we have the three-dimensional density changes up to and accompanying a cone flow. A cone flow is nothing but instead of which if you are using the conical flow, that is a conical section, okay, and the flow may occur. This three-dimensional flow is not said to be the accurate flow. So the shock angle may get different based on different perspectives and different kinds of measurements, so that it is not too accurate, right? So these two conditions are the olden days techniques which have been followed. And then in next session we will going to discuss about the change of nominal Mach number and flow angularity, dryness, longitudinal static pressure gradient, and then turbulence. You will see in part 2 very detailed about this concept. And after part 2, the part 3 will be going to be the calibration studies in hypersonic tunnels and the classification of hypersonic tunnels, what are its characteristics, etc. That's the end of the session. If you have any doubts, just post it in the comment section, and please subscribe for my video for high number of videos to be put on a daily basis. Thank you.